Amen. 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 Are you guys ready to study God's word today? Amen, family. I'm ready to preach it if you're ready to receive it. That wasn't very convincing. First, let me begin by giving you some good news. You guys want some good news today?
Yeah.
Some good news today. Yesterday, I had the great joy and privilege of meeting with and hiring our Hispanic church planter that we have been praying for. Praise God. This is our new friend, Michael. Michael's going to be here May 22nd. He's a fully supported, fully funded, ready to rock and roll NAM church planter. And so we're going to just bring him on board. He's serving at our sister church in Norfolk, just up the street. And so he and his dear wife will be starting their ministry here. End of May, they're going to come here, they're going to meet all of you, and we are going to begin the process of launching Restore Español right here in Yankton. It's going to be, praise God, you guys have been praying so faithfully for this for so long. It's in your bulletin. It's been in your bulletin. Pray for this for week after week after week, and God has answered that prayer and given us a church planter. So, is that exciting, family? God is allowing you he's just rewarding your steadfast faithfulness. And we're people reaching church, amen? That's our second core value, and you're reaching the people. And we are going to reach the people across the street and around the world. We're going to go to the nations. But sometimes, what do we know? Sometimes you go to the nations by going in your backyard where God brought the nations to you. And that's what we're going to do with this next church plant. Today, we are in week two of a sermon series called Roots. Roots is a sermon series where we're going back and we're exploring the basics of our faith. What's something we all know? Strong trees need healthy roots. Amen, family? Large trees need strong roots. And what else do we know? We know that even the mightiest of tree, if its roots are unhealthy, it will fall down. Okay? So may we be a church family that we value occasionally just going back to the roots, exploring the basics of our faith. In fact, if I leave the tree analogy for a second, let me tell you something really important. I would argue this, and I think anybody who is great at anything would argue this as well, that to be great at something often doesn't require a new revelation or a new skill. It requires what? Mastering the fundamentals, right? You talk to anybody who has accomplished something great, much of their success is attributed to mastery of the fundamentals. If you want faith that moves mountains, it's probably not going to be the result of some great innovative teaching that nobody's ever taught before. It's probably going to come from mastering the basics of your faith. Amen, family? And so we're going to spend several weeks going back to the basics of our faith. Last week, we talked about just the most basic core value of Christianity, right? Do you love Jesus? Do you love Jesus? Do you really, sincerely, authentically, genuinely, do you love Jesus? Most basic core value of Christian faith, right? We are Christians, right? We are ones of Christ. Do you love Jesus? Today we're going to talk about a really, really difficult one, and to kind of get you in the mindset of today's conversation, I want to prep you a little bit by playing a little game. Are you guys ready to play a little game today? This game I call Cause and Effect. So I'm going to show you a series of pictures, and I'm going to kind of illustrate some cause and effect, and our first one is one of the best ones. What do we know? One of the great universal truths of the world we live in. The cause, if you put a cat on a counter, creates an effect called nothing else on the counter. Am I right? There's some cat people in the room. A cat on the counter often results in nothing else gets to stay on the counter if the cat is on the counter. It's a cause and effect. How about this next one? That's a good one. This could go lots of directions, but I think I don't know why God designed his world this way, but it seems like one of the universal truths of the world we live in is if you're wearing a white shirt and you eat spaghetti, the cause and the effect is your white shirt ain't all white no more, right? If you give kids spaghetti and white shirt, you might as well just throw the shirt away when you're done, okay? I don't know. It's a cause and effect. But if you eat spaghetti with any shirt other than a white shirt, what happens? You won't spill a drop. So why do I always wear white shirts when I eat spaghetti? I don't know. How about this next one? Okay, this one's crazy. In fact, that wasn't supposed to be a screwdriver. That's supposed to be a fork. That's the wrong picture, but we'll work with it. The cause and effect, a fork in an outlet is how you get curly hair like mine. Just cause and effect, cause and effect. Don't ask me how I know. Cause and effect. Let's look at the next one. This one's kind of sad. But the reality is, me watering your plant equals something like that. Cause and effect. Cause and effect, me watering your plant equals a dead plant. And that's why, but if you have Sophie, if you have a Sophie in your life to water your plants, then she comes to your office and waters your plants for you, and then you have good plants, not that pathetic thing in that picture right there. Cause and effect, cause and effect. Is there one more? I think there's one more. This one's a good one. This one. This one, this one, some of you might be familiar with it. I think there's a cause and effect. For some of you, if there's a stairs, whether it goes up or whether it goes down, the cause is the stairs was there. The effect is you just trip. Wherever there's a stairs, some people trip. Is that anybody in the room today? There's stairs, you trip. I don't know why, but it's the cause and effect of the world we live in. Cause and effect, cause and effect, cause and effect. Now listen, all these are just silly. These are just silly, goofy examples. Remember, not every cause is negative. Not every effect is bad, right? Sometimes there's good cause and good effect. Amen, family. And these have all been silly, but I want to talk to you about a really serious one. Okay, are you guys ready? Amen, family. Really serious cause and effect. Here it is. Jesus in your life should cause hope to be shared in other lives. Amen, family? Jesus in your life should cause hope to be shared in other lives. Let me say it one more time. Jesus in your life should cause hope to be shared in other lives. Okay? Let me say that another way. The transformative power of the gospel in you should cause hope to be shared in others. Amen? The transformative power of the gospel in you should cause hope to be shared in others. Amen, family? Are we excited about the gospel today or not? Amen, family? This is the gospel. This is the power of the gospel. The gospel is a cause, and the effect is hope. Cause and effect, cause and effect, cause and effect. Today, we're going to talk about one of the most important roots in the Christian faith, and that is evangelism. Hope of Jesus that you've experienced, that's transformed your heart, that's moved your life from one position to another, that's just every part of your DNA now. The hope of Jesus that you've experienced should cause hope to be shared with others. And I want to pause right here. We're going to talk about evangelism today. I'm going to pause right here for this reason. Everybody here, I need laser focus. If you're taking notes, just pause your notes for a minute. Just laser focus right here. If you're watching online and you're looking at something else, close out all your windows. Just look right here. Laser focus. Here's why. This is the most intimidating topic I think that we can talk about. In fact, I'm fearful of today's message. The fact that I said the word evangelism, I feel like I maybe lost about 75% of the attention in the room today because everybody's like, I don't want it. I don't want it. If I told you in advance, attendance would have cut by like 80% today, maybe. I hope not. But this is the one where people skip church. This is the one where people are like, they're closing their browser right now. This is the one where some of you are thinking like, if he turns this conversation in the wrong direction, this was the last time I went to Restore Church today if he beats me up too much about evangelism, okay? Laser focus, okay? Here's what I want to do. Let me ease your mind, okay? Today's message is not these few things, okay? Here's what today's message is not. My goal today from the study of God's Word is not to get everybody here feeling obligated to go on the street corner with a blowhorn and a milk crate, okay, and preach, you know, like, you're all going to hell where the worm's going to, how's the saying go? I don't know. Anyway, something bad, right? Like, my goal isn't to get everybody, now let me add to that, though. People who do go out in the street with a blowhorn and a milk crate, if they're preaching the gospel with truth and grace and love, are doing a noble and honorable thing, and they deserve your respect for doing the difficult work of the evangelist. Amen, family? Okay, now if they're doing it with hellfire, brimstone, and no grace, that's a different story. But if they're actually sharing the gospel with truth and love and hope and grace, they're doing a good thing, and they deserve your respect. But what I want to tell you is today's goal is not to get you a feeling of obligation to do that. Okay, are we on the same page? Amen, family? Okay. The other thing is my goal isn't to beat you up with statistics. By the way, the statistics are horrible. Okay, the number of Christians who share their faith with another person in their lifetime are so sad. My goal isn't to beat you up on that either, okay? That's not the goal, okay? Here's what I want to do. Here's what I want to do. I want us to meet in the middle where I think that we're all at. And here's what I think I know about everybody here. I think, okay, you guys tell me if I'm wrong, I think everybody here who loves Jesus actually wants to share Jesus. Amen, family? I don't think there's a person here who loves Jesus and says, I don't want to talk to other people about Jesus. I think everybody here who loves Jesus has a desire. And maybe you already feel bad because you say, I want to do it, but I don't do it as much as I want to. I don't do it at all, and you already feel bad. My goal isn't to make you feel worse about it. Today's goal is to create at least some sense of liberation, to help you feel more confident and comfortable in your witness, to at least, maybe at least, just clear the air a little bit. Amen, family? Does that sound good? That's the goal today, just to clear the air a little bit. Let me tell you one more thing, and we'll get started. Today's message isn't a comprehensive evangelism sermon, okay? There's so much more to be said than I have time to say to you. So the goal isn't to cover everything about evangelism, just a little piece of the conversation today to make sure that we're addressing that healthy root of evangelism. Amen, family? But here's what I believe about all of you. I believe you love Jesus, and you have a sincere desire in your heart to tell other people about the hope you have in Jesus. And if that's you today, let's stand up for the reading of God's word and begin our study. 1 Peter 3, 13 through 18 says this. It says, now who is there to harm you if you are zealous for what is good? But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled, but in your hearts honor Christ the Lord as holy. Always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you. Yet, do so with gentleness and respect. Do so with gentleness and respect, having a good conscience, so that when you are slandered, those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if that should be God's will, than for doing evil. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit. And there's much more to read, but we're going to stop there for time's sake. And as you have your seats, let me kind of build up some context for you. Okay, a little context here. Last week we talked about loving Jesus. And do you guys remember, those of you who are here, what we studied? You look at John 21. If you weren't here, we looked at John 21. And there's this incredible moment in John chapter 21. It's after the resurrection. The resurrected Christ comes and he cooks breakfast for Peter. It's before the ascension. It's after the resurrection. And Peter had it looks like Peter actually abandoned his ministry. And so they have this really special moment between Jesus and Peter where Peter is restored to his ministry by Jesus. Amen, family? And Jesus gave Peter a commission. Instead of calling him to be a fisher of men this time, he calls him to be a what? Shepherd of the flock of God. Now, at the time that this was written, 1 Peter, 2 Peter, was about 30 years later. So about 3 decades had passed since this very special conversation between Jesus and Peter, where he was restored. And now Peter is the shepherd. In fact, in chapter 5 of 1 Peter, you see Jesus repeating the same lesson to the church that Jesus gave him, saying, you guys, be shepherds, shepherd the people of God well. Peter's relaying this same message forward into the next generation. Is that special, family? Amen? That is so special. And in the midst of this, Peter is now teaching us much about shepherding the flock of God well. See, the whole letter of 1 Peter, I'm giving you a little more context where we work up to chapter 3 where we're at. It's the whole letter is evangelistic in tone. So it kind of starts off with Peter just kind of proclaiming the gospel to this church. It's a circular letter, so it went through different parts of the Roman Empire at about the year 60-65 AD, and Peter is relaying this message to the people. Remember the faith you have in Jesus. Remember the gospel that saved your soul. Remember the good news that's transforming your life, even as we speak. And he kind of leaves out this message, kind of lays out this message for the people, where what he's telling them, he's saying, listen, while you're loving Jesus, you need to make sure you're winning people to Christ. Amen, family? And the whole letter is kind of filled with different types of evangelistic encouragement. So he lays out a couple examples. He says, one of the things he says, listen, there's always going to be a government that rules over you in some way, shape, or form, and they may mistreat you. They may not mistreat you, but they may mistreat you. If they mistreat you or if they don't mistreat you, win them to Christ. Then he talks about masters and bosses. He says, you might have a boss who rules over you, might have a master who rules over you, and they might mistreat you. They might not mistreat you, but whatever they do, win them to Christ. He talks about marriage. He says, you maybe have a spouse who's not on the same page with you faith-wise, okay? Fine. Win them to Christ. Win them to Christ. Win them to Christ. And he goes through all these different areas of life, and he's just basically laying out this message of evangelism. Win them to Jesus. Win them to Jesus. Win them to Jesus. Turn to someone next to you and say, let's win them to Jesus. Turn to someone next to you and say it. Good job on that, because I was going to pick on you. If you can't say it to your neighbor at church, how can you say it to your stranger out in the street? I'm just saying, okay, win them to Jesus. Win them to Jesus, win them to Jesus. And that's what that's basically what 1 Peter is. It's a series of encouragements to say if life is easy, and especially if life is hard, hold on to the hope you have and win everybody everywhere to Jesus, and to God be the glory forever and ever. And all God's people said, amen. Now, how do we do that, or why is it so hard to do that? That's the question, right? Here's what I believe about everybody here. I believe you have a sincere desire to win people to Christ. I believe most of us don't engage in that battle, though, because it's difficult. Is that fair? So what I want to do is I want to cover three realities of evangelism that I hope will liberate us in our heart and soul. Here's the first one, okay? The first one's hard, the second one's harder, and then we're going to end on a high note. Are you ready? Okay, here's the first one. You cannot share what you do not have. Plain and simple. You cannot share what you do not have. One more time. You cannot share what you do not have. See, Peter says right there in verse 15, that's kind of where I want to focus. He says what? He says, in your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy. Who can do that? Only a saved person can do that. Only a person who loves Jesus can do that. In your hearts, honor the Lord Christ as holy, always, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you, yet with gentleness and respect. So what he's saying is, those of you who love Jesus, be ready to give a defense. Be ready to explain why the hope you have in Jesus is, in fact, the hope you have in Jesus. And here's the thing. You can't share that if you don't have it. You cannot share what you do not have. And here's where I just want to be really sensitive and really careful, but we have to talk about it. Some of you, perhaps, are not sharing the hope of Jesus because you have not yet experienced the hope of Jesus. Some of you, perhaps, and it's sad, but it's true. People can do this. It's sad. Some of you, perhaps, do church but don't love Jesus. Right? And it's scary how easy it is to be empowered to do that. And you know, one of my goals as your pastor with everything I have is to make it difficult for you to do church and not love Jesus. We want to be a place where there's an infectious love of Jesus, where you're just here and you're just showered in the love of Jesus and you can't leave here without loving Jesus. That's one of our goals. But the thing is you might just be doing church. Here, what does that mean? You might show up week in and week out and you sit in your favorite seat. and you nudge your favorite person, and you listen to your favorite preacher, you know, and you worship with your favorite worship team. And you can get excited about that one. The preaching's okay. The music's really good. That's our theme here, okay? And you show up. And maybe you serve. Because you know what? Doggone it, it feels good to serve. It does. It feels good to serve. You should serve. It's a noble cause to serve. And you're more blessed serving probably than the people you actually serve. And maybe you show up and you sit down and you participate and you serve and you're kind to people. You might even throw a little money in the offering because it feels really good to give. Blessed are those who give. It's better to give than to receive, and you do that. And all of these are good and noble things, okay? They're all good and noble things. But the reality is that you might just be doing church. You might just do it for you and not for Jesus. You might do it for you because it feels good. It eases your conscience. It helps you relinquish yourself of some of the guilt that you feel because you feel good. These are good things. God wired us to feel good doing good things for him. But the reality is, somewhere along the way, while you're doing church, somewhere along the way, you have to decide if you trust Jesus or not. Somewhere along the way, you have to decide if you really trust Jesus. See, and here's what I don't mean. I don't mean, do you believe he existed 2,000 years ago? That's not what I mean. I don't mean, do you believe that he did miracles 2,000 years ago? At some point, you have to decide if you truly trust Jesus. Here's what I do mean by that. 2,000 years ago, Jesus claimed to have this immense power to do some incredible things that would last far beyond 2,000 years ago. And you and I have to face some hard realities to grasp the depth of what Jesus claimed to have the power to do. Are you guys ready? Can I get it in your face just a little bit? Is that okay, family? Amen? Okay, so here's the reality. You and I, at some point, we have to decide if we trust Jesus. In order to decide if we really trust Jesus, we have to acknowledge some difficult facts. Fact number one, you and I have to acknowledge that we are, in fact, sinners. You're a sinner. I'm a sinner. Every person ever born in the history of humanity, except for one, Jesus, is a sinner. Jesus is not a sinner. Everybody but Jesus is a sinner. And we have to come to the reality that that includes you and me. Amen, family? We just have to come to the terms with that. And then you have to come to terms with this other hard reality. Not only have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, but your sin, if nothing changes, your sin will lead to your ultimate and eternal condemnation. We have to acknowledge that if we're sinners and nothing changes, we have to face ultimate and eternal condemnation. We also have to acknowledge this other really difficult thing, that you're not strong enough, you're not charming enough, you're not smart enough, you're not handsome enough, you're not kind enough, you're not good enough to remove your sins by your own ability. We have to acknowledge that we are not enough to get rid of our sin. And this is where you have to decide if you trust in Jesus. Because Jesus promised, Jesus made these incredible claims about himself. He said, listen, even though you're not strong enough, you're not enough to do it for yourself, I'm enough, Jesus said, to do it for the world. Jesus claimed, he made these claims about himself 2,000 years ago that he said, I'm going to go to the cross. I'm going to die on the cross. I'm going to shed my blood on the cross. And my blood is the ransom for many, that whosoever believes in me will not perish but have everlasting life. That he could wash away your sins with his blood. And he made this incredible claim upon himself that you're not enough, but he said, I'll be enough for you. He made a promise. He said, I love you and I will do this for you. And you have to, at some point, decide whether or not you trust him to do for you what he said he could and did do for you. That he did die on the cross for your sins. That he did not stay dead. He rose on the third day. And that whoever puts their faith in him, whoever believes in him, whoever repentantly believes in Jesus, whoever trusts in Jesus, he says, will enter eternity with him because he is the way, the truth, and the life. And at some point, while you're doing church, you have to decide if you trust Jesus. And until you do so, you cannot share what you do not have. But when you put your faith in Jesus, amen, family? When you put your faith in Jesus, he becomes the hope of the world which dwells in you. And so then when Peter talks in this situation, he says, hey, always be ready to give a defense for the hope that you have. The hope that you have is the Savior you love who died for your sins and has secured your soul. And there's a special place he prepared for you in heaven because he loves you. Always be ready. You have a reason for that hope that you have. And here's the reality. Some of us can't share it because we don't have it. Now, again, I never say these things to be condemning, right? I'm just saying this to be inviting. Today's the day. Today could be the day for you that if that's you, if you've just been doing church, if you've just been showing up, if you've just been going through the motions, today could be the day where you say, Jesus, I'm done doing church. I'm ready to start serving my Savior, the Savior I love, the Savior of the world, and I do trust in you, Jesus. I am yours. And I beg you with everything I have, if that's you today, don't leave here quietly keeping this to yourself. Don't sneak out the door. Don't blend in the crowd. At the end of this service, there's going to be a time to respond. I'm going to be sitting up here at the end of the service ready to pray, and you come up. And don't worry about who's watching you, because anybody who's watching you come up today, do you know what they're doing? They're cheering you on. They're not judging you. They're cheering you on. They want to see you surrender to Jesus. They're rooting for you. They want to see you make that. And so if you were here for years and years and years just doing church and you come up today, nobody's going to be embarrassed for you or about you. They're going to be happy for you. Today might be the day. Don't leave here not being able to share the something you don't have when it's right here being offered to you. Jesus offered it, so let's take it. Amen, family? Let's take what Jesus offered. The hope of the world. But you cannot share what you do not have. It's extraordinary the context that this was written to. See, Peter's writing into the Roman church around 60 AD, and the Roman church around 60 AD was under the rule of this evil king named Nero. Some of you guys might remember, we talked about Nero last year. He was a horrible, horrible, horrible emperor. He did these atrocious things. A couple of things he did, he was obsessed with building things. You know, great Roman architectures, but he ran out of things to build in Rome. Everything was built. So it's theorized that he started this great Roman fire so the city would be burned up and he could rebuild what he destroyed. Now, it kind of backfires when your people find out that you burned their crown city. They're a little upset. So what he did is he blamed it. This is theorized. He blamed it on the Christians. The Christians who are already kind of persecuted, already kind of outcast because of their faith in Jesus. Now he further alienates them, and he did these horrible things to them. Here's a couple of things he did. He would clothe them in animal skins. This is kind of morbid. I'm sorry, guys. This is too morbid for you. But this is what he did. He clothed them in animal skins, and he would put them basically in these cages, and he'd have packs of wild dogs come in, and for entertainment, he would watch the dogs tear them to pieces. This is what evil King Nero did to Christians. What he would do is he would dip them in wax, and he would bind them to trees, and he would turn them into human candles. And what I want you to understand is these are the people that Peter's writing to when he says, always be ready to give a defense for the faith, for the hope that you have. So he's already assuming the whole point of the whole context of this message is listen, I know you already love Jesus. What's the preceding verse? He says, be zealous for doing what's good. He says, I know you love Jesus and you're already sharing Jesus when it's good. But when it's bad, when people come after you for doing what's good, continue to be ready to have the hope within you shared with others. This is clicking, family. Amen. Be ready to share the hope that you have. And history is filled with Christians who have died for their faith and inspired people with their hope along the way. The one story just strikes me so powerfully. I don't remember what era it was, but there was a series of Christians who were actually burned alive at the stake for their faith in Jesus. And one such family, the dad is marching bravely and fearlessly to be executed for his sharing of the gospel. He marches to the object of his demise, singing hymns of praise. And he sees his son and his wife as he marches. His son and his wife are so inspired by his faith that rather than his son saying, "Daddy, don't do it. Daddy, give up your faith. Daddy, turn your back on the God who saved your soul." Instead of doing any of those things or pleading with him to do that, mom and son began singing the hymn with him, which erupted into a chorus of praise as these individuals were martyred for their faith. And I don't remember if it's this story or another one like it, but there's so many of these stories. In one story I read, the executors were so moved by their faith in Jesus, by the hope that they were ready to proclaim, that what they did is they said, "If what they're doing is illegal, I have to die too." And they went and they took their own stake, and they got executed right alongside the people they were executing for their love of Jesus. Why am I telling this to you? I'm just telling you, Peter is trying to equip us by God's word. God, through his word, through Peter, is trying to equip us to be a hopeful people, right? Because God sent you to be into the world, to share the hope of the world with a world that is in dire need of hope. Amen, family? It's cause and effect. Christ in you should cause hope to be shared with others, but you cannot share what you do not have. Okay? You cannot share what you do not have, but Christ with us brings hope in us to share with those among us. Amen? Christ with us brings hope in us to share with those among us. It's cause and effect. It's cause and effect. And I just want to say this really sensitively. Is this okay? Is this kind of too in your face? Let me just say one more thing. It's a little more in your face. If you have experienced the hope of Christ in your life, it's hard to imagine that you really could just keep it to yourself. Can we let that sit in the air for a minute? If you've really experienced the depth of the gospel that Jesus Christ died to wash away your... The Son of God died for you and for your sins and gave you a gift of eternal life. It's hard to fathom that we're capable of keeping that to ourselves. Isn't it? Let me bring you to the second reality of evangelism. Remember, I hope this is liberating, okay? The reality right now is I want to invite everybody to have hope in Christ. Hopefully you can share it because you do have it. That's the only reason for point number one. If you don't have it, get it. If you got it, let's good, right? Amen, family? That's the only point of point number one. Point number two is to kind of help start liberating you a little bit. Here's point number two. You won't share what you always intended to keep to yourself. Why is evangelism so hard? Why is sharing our faith so hard? Because the reality is some of us received a gift that we never actually planned on sharing. Is that fair? You will never share what you always intended to keep. There's some things you should never share, right? Gum, underwear, steak, right? And I don't know, maybe there's some exceptions. Maybe you were kissing your significant other, you forgot to spit out your gum, and the rest of the story is between you, them, and God. Okay, I don't need to know about it. Most of the time, you don't want to share gum. Maybe there was an emergency. An underwear emergency, you do you, whatever you got to do, and maybe you had to share some underwear one day. That's between you and God as well. Most of the time, that's not something you want to share. And maybe you're weird and you don't eat all the steak that's prepared for you and you share that. But I'm just telling you, a steak wasn't made to be shared. It was made to be eaten one serving. No matter how big it is, you gobble that thing up. And all of the men in the house said, amen, amen, amen. Amen. Some things you don't share because you never intended to, and that's okay. But some things were not meant to be kept to yourself. Chief among them, the gospel. The gospel is not something given to you with you to be able to expect yourself to only keep it with you. Can we get, man, is this, I want this to be liberating, and I want this to be like a just a beating for everybody. Can we go a little bit deeper in that? Amen, family, ready? Here's the reality. Some of us look at verse 15, and what does he say in verse 15? He says, be ready to give, to share the hope you have with those who ask. And you look at that last phrase, with those who ask, and you just rejoice, and you just have this sigh of relief, and you're like, oh, yes, I don't have to do it unless somebody asks me. What that's called is an excuse. And what do we know about excuses at Restore Church? Good excuses continue to be good excuses as long as you use them. Good excuses don't become bad excuses. The good excuse you use today will be a good excuse to use tomorrow, so just acknowledge it's an excuse and get over it. We say, Peter only told me I need to have an answer for my hope ready if somebody asks me. He's also assuming that you're so zealous for your good works that people will notice and go out of their way to ask you. Let's kind of hang our hat on both sides of the conversation there. But we have good excuses. Well, nobody asked me, so I don't have to share it. So here are some of the excuses we come up with, right? We say, well, I don't want to sound like those burn and turn preachers out there who are always kind of doing that, right? Is that fair? Okay, good. Don't sound like them. Sound like a grace-filled preacher, right? There you go. Problem solved, right? I'm going to be sensitive about this, but you got to hear me out, okay? I'm an introvert, okay? Listen, introverts among us, I love you. I respect you. I'm not asking you to be an extrovert, okay? Can we clear that up? Introvert, I love you. If God made you an introvert, be an introvert, okay? But I want you to acknowledge something about yourself, introverts. Can I make you be uncomfortable and raise your hand? That's the worst thing to have an introvert do, right? Here's the reality. Introverts, do you know you have a superpower? Do you know that? When you speak, it's well thought out and people listen because you're an introvert. I'm not telling you to go get a blowhorn and go on the street corner and stand on a milk crate. I'm not telling you to do that. I'm just saying, are you ready? Tell people about the hope you have if and when God calls you. Give an answer for the hope you have. Right? This isn't me trying to make, remember, I want you to be liberated. Okay? I want you to be liberated. I'm not trying to guilt you. I'm not trying to beat you up. I just say, like, are you obedient to the Lord you love? What did he say? I don't know any other way to read this other than he says, be ready. And if you're not ready, then you're not ready. But he said to be ready. And if he said be ready and you're not ready, is this fair? Amen, family? I've told you, this is the sermon everybody wants to skip. Here's the reality, okay? It's not a lack of motivation. It's an out-of-place motivation. Here's the reality. Some of us will never share Christ not because we don't want to. We want to share Jesus. I know everybody here wants to. You don't walk around looking at people and saying, you know what? Screw them. I hope they never hear about Jesus. You don't walk. I hope you don't. You don't walk around saying, like, I hope they go to hell. Man, if there's only one way to heaven and it's Jesus and any other way is not the way to heaven, you don't say, like, I hope they never hear the good news. That's not how any of you think. You want to share Jesus. The reality is your motivation rests in your comfort rather than the sacrifice required to lead them to Jesus. It's not that you're not motivated. You're just motivated by something else. You're motivated to have more time, more free time. You're motivated to have more comfort. You're motivated to avoid awkward conversations. You're motivated to maybe keep a friendship that you think you might lose, which honestly, that's probably not a friendship if it's that fragile, right? You're motivated for this. You're motivated for that. And the reality is you're just motivated by something else, and you're more motivated by that something else than you're motivated by the gospel. Can we just acknowledge that? You will never share what you always intended to keep. Until your intentions with the gospel change, that you intend to share it, you're not going to share it. Plain and simple. But I skipped this in the first service. You guys want to hear it? As painful as this is to say, if you cannot share the hope you have when it's good, you may find yourself denying Jesus when it's bad. People dying all around the world, carrying this message of hope. In other nations and peoples and tribes and languages, dying for this. Because they believe so deeply in Jesus as the hope of the world. If we can't share Jesus with people when it's good, are we going to be capable of sharing Jesus when we're the persecuted? Romans 10 says this powerful word. Everyone who believes in him will not be put to shame, for there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. For the same Lord is Lord of all, bestowing his riches on all who call on him. Listen to these verses. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved, but how can they call on him in whom they have not believed? But how can they believe if they've never heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching? And how can they preach unless they're sent? How can they preach unless they're sent? Restore church. How can we preach if we've not been sent? And then it goes to say this, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. And as awkward as it is, can I just ask you the dumbest question you'll hear today? Do you have beautiful or ugly feet? He says, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. See, what we do is, though, you're never going to share what you always intended to keep. You'll never share it. You'll never share it. You'll never share it. You'll never share it until your intentions change. Some of us look at like things like Ephesians 4:11 and we say, well, some are prophets, some are apostles, some are evangelists. And I'm not the sum that are evangelists. I'm not them, and so they can do it, and I can do me, and they can do them. I'm not calling you all to the office of evangelists. Their ministry is different. If you're called to the ministry of evangelism, nobody has to twist your arm. You're already doing it if you're called to the ministry. I'm talking about being obedient to Christ. This message and Peter's words here are not about, they're not about motivation, they're about preservation. But he's assuming Christians at least have the ability to describe why they love Jesus. It's that simple, right? I'm not talking about some methodical formula where you have to go have these complex conversations and these 18 points on like, here's the 27,000 reasons you believe in Jesus. All we're talking about is saying like, why do you hope in Jesus? Why do you hope in Jesus? And having that on the ready to share with others. Amen, family? Is this getting too heavy? Am I losing you on this one? Because I got one more point. I really want to bring it home. Are you guys ready? Okay, here's the third one, okay? Number one, you cannot share what you do not have. You will not share what you always intended to keep, but you will share what you prepared for others. You will share what you prepared for others. You will share what you prepared for others. My neighbors and I, man, we got it made. We got it made, bro. We got it made or what? Say we've got it made. Or else I'm going to look like a liar. Do we got it made? Okay. All right. My neighbors and I, we kind of have this agreement that if any of us make dessert or go someplace that has really good dessert, we either have to make or buy extra to come and share with each other. Well, I'm so well fed. Okay, I got good neighbors. They're less well fed because they got okay neighbors. But they're okay with that. It's kind of the culture in our neighborhood. We trade dessert for each other on a regular basis. Why? We have intentions to prepare dessert for one another. You will share what you prepared for others. See, this passage is saying, be ready. Be ready. What does that mean? It's you have something prepared. You have 1 Peter 3:15 says the same thing. Sorry, not, that's the one we just read. There, what's the other one? 1 Timothy says the same thing. Be ready in season and out of season. Right? And I want you to understand what he said to have ready. Here's what Peter didn't say to have ready. He didn't say you need to always have ready a reason to argue your deepest theological nuances with people. He didn't say you always have to be ready to show everybody why your political stance on everything is right and everybody else's stance is wrong. He didn't say you always have to be ready to have that you're right about COVID-19 and everybody else is wrong. He didn't say to always be ready about vaccines or mask mandates. He didn't say to always be ready. He didn't say always be ready to talk about your favorite sports team or your sports player or defense for whatever it is. He said always be ready. You're the hope that's within you. Talking about Jesus. Always be ready. But what if? What if Restore Church looked like this, that we're a people always ready, that perhaps when we wake up in the morning, we sit on the edge of our bed in a posture of openness and we pray to the Savior we love and we say, oh Lord, give me somebody to talk to about the hope I have in you today. And you start your day in a posture of readiness. What if, or what if you end your day? God, thank you so much for the person that you put on my path today. I rejoice that you let me witness to them. I pray that you bring the growth because you're in charge of the growth, my God, whom I love. What if we live in a state of readiness? What if? What if you had something just written out so that you're not clumsy because you don't have any confidence, your ability to speak, and you just wrote something out that you're always ready to just have this, the briefest conversation about why Jesus gives you hope. Amen, family? What if? What if? Here's what I know about you. I know you love Jesus. And I know that if you love Jesus, you have a desire to tell others about Jesus. You want to share Jesus? Then get ready. Get ready. Have a change of intention. It says, I will share Jesus. And other than that, I'm not going to tell you what to do. I think you could go and spend 30 minutes this week sitting down with a pen and a paper in a closed, quiet room. I'll babysit your kids if that's what you need to get this done. Come, drop your kids off at the kids' campus with my wife, and I'll babysit your kids. And go take 30 minutes to be alone and write down why you have hope in Jesus. If you don't have hope in Jesus, then I don't want you to feel hopeless. I want to give you hope in Jesus today. He loves you so much. He died on the cross for your sins. He shed his blood to wash away your sins. He rose from the grave so that you could be resurrected for all eternity. Amen, family? He gave that to you. 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 So who is Jesus calling you to share Jesus with this week? What if you just picked one person today? And you're just going to practice and say, hey, you know what? I'm going to get ready. I'm going to practice. And I'm going to go share them with Jesus. And you realize that wasn't so bad. I'm going to go talk to this person about Jesus and this person about Jesus. Because you know what? That first one wasn't so bad. You just needed to get started with a change of intention. I'm going to talk to this person about Jesus. And next thing you know, shoot, God called me to the ministry of evangelism. And now you're toast. But what if? See, the message today is about cause and effect. If the hope of Jesus lives in you, the hope of Jesus should be shared with others. Cause and effect. But what if? What if Restore Church was a cause and a major shift in every community we touch was an effect? What if? What if we keep striving to make 3 million disciples in the next 20 years, but what if along the way we led 10% of Yankton to Christ in the next 5 years? What if? That's only 1,500 people. What if in the next 3 years? What if in the next 2 years? Because today, rather than just being people who do church, we become the cause to God's effect. And in the next 2 years, what if 3% of Yankton got saved? What if? Family, I don't want to do this by myself, but I'll do it if you're not going to help me. I'd really appreciate the help, though. What if you were the cause and the effect was the salvation of many? God didn't bring you here by accident today. You're here for a reason. This is your first time, your second time, your 50th time after skipping church for like 10 years. Whatever it is, you're not here for any accident. You're here for a cause. What's going to be the effect? So we're going to stand and we're going to sing this last song. As we do, what I want to have you do is, if you've never had hope from Jesus, you know what? Come on up. I'm right here. Let's talk about it. Let's talk about it. If you don't have hope in Jesus and Jesus is calling you to himself to be the hope in your life, then come on up. Let's talk about it. Don't, remember, nobody's watching. If anybody's watching, it's only to cheer you on and not to condemn you. And if you need to recommit that hope in Jesus, that you're gonna share the hope that you have, then come on up. Let's commit to it. Let's commit to it. Father God, we praise you. We praise you for just the awe and wonder we have in you. We praise you for the works that you're doing among us. We praise you for the souls that are saved. On a regular basis, we're seeing people come to you. We praise you for the gift of evangelism. It's not a burden. It's not a pain. It's not a struggle. It's an honor, because beautiful are the feet of those who carry the good news. And so may we be a church just with beautiful feet and hope-filled hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. What if